is on the definite inset round and the area under the curve. Over the past weeks, we've learned all about differentiation. What is it? How do you find the derivative of all kinds of functions and some of the applications? Calculus is made up of two parts, differentiation and integral. Now that we've wrapped up the part one of calculus, it's time we take another beast, which is part two of calculus. But even though I introduced it on our last session, And another thing, at the beginning, I said integration is the opposite of differentiation. So the two goes hand in hand. It's nothing one is better than another thing, another one, or anything else. It's just that they are opposites of one another. You'll never understand the integration if you have no idea what differentiation is. So if you don't understand, I suggest you go back to the material now or in your spare time. Please admit the one in the lobby. Okay, I want us to take some time and understand what is integral, what does it represent? Because after this, we're going back to our previous session and we're going to find the integral there.
Realistic now.
So again, the question would be, what is the integral? In calculus, we define the integral as the area under the curve between two points. For example, please mute your mic. For example, suppose you are given a function. Suppose you are given a function. Y equals f of x. And just a second, as you know, so I'm just going to mute my mic. Okay, I was saying, suppose you are given a function y equals f of x, and you are told that this function is bounded between x equals a and x equals b. and you are asked to find the area under the expansion between these two points. Okay. Mathematically, we write this as, okay, we'll have to integrate the expansion between these two limits, right, A and B. Okay, mathematically, we can write this as area equals integral of A, B, f at x, dx. And this is equal to an integral of fx between A and B. And this is the same thing as f of A, no, f of B minus f of A, the lower limit, the upper limit minus the lower limit. This is how you'll find the area of this function. Okay. For example, suppose we are given our function f at x is, okay, you are given your function f at x is f at x equals 4x cubed plus 3x squared minus 2x plus 3. Right. Okay, we can find an area under this function. Let's say we are asked to find the area of this function between x equals 1 and x equals 3, right? Okay, we're going to use this formula for the area, which is the integral of the function, which is f of x dx from A to B, right? Please mute your mic. This equals, okay, 1 and 3. And our f at x is given as 4x cubed plus 3x squared. Please excuse my writing. I'm using my finger today again, because even now my pen doesn't want to write. But luckily, today is our last class. Minus 2x plus 3x. This that dx is very important, because it tells you that you are differentiating this function with respect to x, right? If we differentiate this function, let's say we were told, okay, let me remove this first, right? Let me remove this 2 and this x1 and x2. I will remove these 2 again. Okay, suppose we were told to find the area of this function, and then they didn't specify the limits, like between x equals 1 and x. Can you hear me? It's like my network is bad.
We lost you there for a minute, yes.
You're breaking, ma'am, but we can hear you now. Hi, ma'am. You've been quiet for like 30 seconds now.
I'm back. My network was bad, so I had to hotspot myself with my phone. Thank you. Thank you for waiting. Can you still see my stream?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. But saying, if you were told to find the area of that function f(x), right, and you were not, they were not specific with the limits, with the boundaries, like you were not told that find the area of this function between x equals maybe 1 and x equals 3, you were going to do a normal integration. The one where you have to add, the constant of integration at the end, and that is called the indefinite integral, right? Okay, so if the x's are not given, the values of the limits, the area of this function would be, okay, now I suppose you guys, you did go through the recording and you familiarize yourself with the rules of integrations, the ones that we did last time on our last session. So I'm not going to say which rule am I using. I'm just going to integrate and give you the answer. Okay. If we integrate 4x cubed, we'll have x to the power 4. Plus, if we integrate 3x squared, we'll have x cubed. And if we integrate minus 2x, we'll have minus x squared. And if we integrate 3, we'll have plus 3x. Because we are done with all the terms, we add the constant of integration. Because we are not sure whether the initial function, the original function, had a constant. So that's why we're adding a constant here. This is the area of f at x, right? But if you were told, you were given conditions, they find the area of f at x between x equals 1 and x equals 3. I'm still going to use those. Okay. Find the area of f at x between x equals 1 and x equals 3. This is how we're going to find the area of this function. You'll have f at x dx between x equals 1, x equals 3. And this will give you an integral from 1 to 3 of 4x3 plus x cubed minus x. It's the integration. It's after the integration now. Plus 3x squared minus 2x plus 3 dx, right? Okay, these are our limits, 1 and 3. since we now have limits, meaning we are solving definite integral, you don't have to add the constant of integration because at the end, they will cancel each other. So to integrate this, this is how you do it. You integrate 4x cubed, that will give you x to the power 4, right? And then you integrate 3x squared, you'll get plus x cubed. You integrate minus 2x, you get minus x squared. You integrate 3, you get plus 3x. And then you indicate that you have limits. I'll write this as x equals 1 and x equals 3. Then the next step is to substitute your limits in this function. Remember, I said the formula for area after, okay, I said this f at x from a to b is equal to f of b minus f of a. So from f, after integrating it, we substitute the upper limit, which is this one on top, and then we subtract or substitute the lower limit, which is this one in the bottom. And if we do that, we'll have.
Yes.
I want to mic.
It's a
bang.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Can you still see my screen, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. 3 squared plus 3 times 3, right? Then you subtract, now you substitute 1. So you have 1 to the power 4 plus 1 cubed minus 1 squared plus 3 times 1. Okay, you punch this in your calculator. First, we have 3 to the power 4, that's 81, right? So you have 81. We have 3 to the power 3, that is 27. So plus 27. We have 3 squared is minus 3. And we have 3 times 3, that is 9. Is plus 9. Then minus, you have 1 to the power 4, it's 1. You have 1 to the power 3, it's 1. You have minus 1 to the power 2, that's minus 1. You have 3 times 1, that's plus 3, right? And then if you punch this in your calculator, you should get 81 plus 27. Okay, we have 81 plus 27 minus 9 plus 9. Okay, this 9 and 9 will cancel out. So this means we have 81 plus 27. That gives us 99 minus. Here you have 1 plus 1 minus 1 plus 3. That will give you minus, that will give you 1, right? Because we have 2 minus 1, that is 1. What?
Hi, ma'am.
Listen, this will cancel out and you'll have four. So this is my, yes. It's 27 plus. Yes, it's 108. 108. And then you have four this side. Mm. So it's minus four. And then this will give you 104. Mm-hmm. And this is the total area, is the area of that function bounded between x equals 1 and x equals 3. Okay. Here is the reason we don't have to put the constant of integration, right? Okay, let's say we had C here. Let's say we had plus C here, right? This means here we'll have plus C. And if there we have plus C, that means even here we'll have plus C. Okay, that means when you substitute 3, we'll have plus C, and when you substitute 1, we'll have plus C, right? And then again, here we still have plus C, and here we still have plus C. But then when we go down here, it would be 108 plus C, then minus 4 minus C. This C and C, they will cancel out. That's why there's no need for us to write them. Before I do another example, do we have questions? Okay.
I'm sorry, ma'am. Sorry.
Yes.
Why is it minus C next to minus 4 and not plus C? Am I missing something?
Because remember here we had plus, okay. We have this minus. This minus multiply everything in this bracket, right? Mm. Here we have plus 4 plus C. So we'll have minus 4 times 4 and minus times C.
Okay, cool. Okay, got it.
Yes, no? Okay, let's try and do another example. Suppose we are given a function like this. Okay, suppose we are given a function like this, f at x equals x squared plus 8x over x cubed. And then we are asked to find the area of this function, of this curve, over the interval x over this interval x greater or equal to 3 and x less or equal to 10. Okay, this interval is the same x equals 3 and x equals 10, you'll get the same thing, right? and we are asked to find the area under this curve over this interval. Okay, remember I said if you are given a function like this, before you integrate it, it's better to simplify it first so that it will be easy for you to integrate it. And if we simplify this function, we will have 1 over x plus 8 over x squared, right? Do we all agree? Then now, since we have a function, our simplified function, we can find its area. Okay, area of f at x, x between x equals 3 and x equals 10 is equal to an integral of 1 over x plus 8 minus 2 dx, x equals 3 and 10. Okay. Then after this step, you can integrate. And if you integrate this, you'll have ln in x, right? And then we have 8 and minus 2, right? Remember, we are adding there, we're adding 1, then we divide. And if we do that, we'll have minus 1, then that means we'll have 8 divided by minus 1, and that will give us minus 8. X minus 1, right? And then we have x equals 3 and x equals 10, right? Okay, and then the next step is to substitute your limits. The upper limit first. Okay, if you substitute the lower limit first, your area might be negative, and we do not have a negative value. Okay, here. So we always substitute the upper limit. So we have ln of 10, right? Minus 8 over 10. And then minus, we have ln of 3 minus 8 over 3. Okay. And then if you do this, you'll have ln 10 minus ln 3. And then you can please check for me what is 8 over 10 plus minus 8 over 10 plus 8 over 3. You can punch that in your calculator. It's fine. That is 8 over 10 plus 8 over 3. And this would be the area of that function, of this function, of this given function between over this interval. Before we move on, do we have questions?
Yes, ma'am. Why is it plus 8 over 3, not minus 8 over 3? your last step?
Yeah, we have negative times ln 3 that gave us minus ln 3, and we had negative times negative 8 over 3 that gave us plus 8 over 3.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and I'm listening.
Which rule did you use it? At first, for you to get 1 over x, the first step.
At 1 over 8?
The yeah. 1 over x. Yes.
I used the power rule of integration, which I taught on Monday.
Okay, no problem. So it means that if I do it on the side, I'll be able to get to this answer, the 1 over x plus 8 over x.
If your corrections are correct, yes.
Okay, no problem. I'll do that. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sorry, ma'am. I just want to ask, when we were doing integration last time, aren't we dividing by the exponent?
We were. We were. The exponent here
dividing by the new exponent.
Yes, we are dividing by the new exponent. We had minus 2, then you add 1 and minus 2, you'll get minus 1. Then 8 divide by minus 1, you'll get 8, right? If you multiply 8 by minus 1 and you divide 8 by minus 1, I see where the confusion is. You get the same answer, but we're dividing here. Is it fine? Can we move on? Okay, can yes, you guys ma'am. Still hear me?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I have a question.
I'm listening.
So ln 10 minus ln 3 cannot be further simplified.
You can punch it in your calculator and get the real number.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay, let's move on to our last chart in this module, which is the application of integration. Okay, on Monday, we looked at the theory of integration, rules of integration, and what does the integration represent in real life. Okay, that's that part. That's what we're doing the first few minutes, because it represents the area of the curve. Okay, so now we're going to look at its application and the learning objectives after this session. We should know how to apply integration to find total revenue and total cost functions from, okay, given the marginal revenue and the marginal cost. And again, apply integration to find total quantity given the rate of change in the quantity. And apply definite integral to determine the consumer supplies, producer surplus, and the total surplus. Okay, two things that you need to know in this session, right? Marginal cost is the derivative of the total cost, and marginal revenue is the derivative of the total revenue. This means, we said marginal cost is the derivative of the total cost. Remember this sign I said it represents the derivative. And then marginal revenue is the derivative of the total revenue. Okay. Those are the two things that you need to know in this section. Right. Okay. If we say the marginal cost is the derivative of the total cost, this means we have marginal cost equals DTC of DQ, right? And then this also means, this also implies total cost is equal to an integral of marginal cost with respect to Q, the quantity. Remember, I said the integration is the reverse process of differentiation, right? So if we are told that the marginal cost is the derivative of the total cost, right? That means to get the total cost, you have to integrate the marginal cost, right? Remember, in the application of differentiation, you were given the total cost and you were asked to find the marginal cost, right? And then you differentiated the total cost to find the marginal cost. Now, suppose you are given, it's vice versa. You are given the marginal cost and you are asked to find the total cost. You just have to integrate that marginal cost, right? Okay. Suppose you are given the marginal cost as MC, which is the derivative of the total cost with respect to Q. Remember, we're differentiating with respect to Q is 150 over Q, right? And then, okay, you are given this marginal cost as 150 over Q, right? Given that the total cost of producing 10 units, it's 50 rand, find the total cost function, right? You are told, okay, you are given the marginal cost function as 150 over Q. And then again, you are told that the total cost of producing 10 units is 50 rand, and you are asked to find the total cost function, right? Remember, I said to move from the marginal cost to the total cost, you just have to differentiate that marginal cost. Okay, let's do that. We have total cost equals the integral of marginal cost. Marginal cost is a function of Q, and we are integrating with respect to Q. And this is the same thing as 150 over Q. DQ, remember, we can take out Q since Q is a constant. If we do that, we'll have 150, an integral of 1 over Q dQ. And this will give us 150 ln Q plus C, right? We are adding C because, remember, I said you won't add C if you are given the limit, which is the lower limit and the upper limit, right? Here, we are not given those limits. Okay, but we were told that the total cost of, okay, this is the total cost function, right? Then we were given an additional information that the total cost of producing 10 units is 50 rand, right? So that simply means the total cost is equal to 50 when Q, which is the quantity, is equal to 10, because they said the total cost of producing the unit is 10, and the Q stands for, represents the unit, the quantity that we are producing, selling. Okay, then the next step is to substitute these two. Where there is total cost, you put 50 equals to 150 lin. Where there is Q, you substitute Q with 10. Then you have plus C. You see, from here we can solve for C. If we solve for C, we'll have C equals 50 minus 150 lin 10. Whatever answer you'll get from here, you can just substitute it here, back here. And after substituting that, you'll see that means your total cost function will equal to 150 lin Q, then plus the value of C, which is plus 50 minus 150 lin 10. Do we have questions?
May you scroll upwards, please?
I think I'm lost, ma'am.
Why did I leave you?
Where is the 150 link Q coming from? Actually, I joined the class late, so I don't understand what's going on.
If you got here late, I'm sorry, I can't help you.
Okay.
Please go back to the recording if you get stuck on what I was teaching. Please try solving those questions based on your understanding, and then you can send it to me via email, then I will check. Yeah, I cannot go back for someone who got.
Okay, so where do I get the recording now?
Okay, this one would be under lesson 7, under the last lesson, because okay, this is the last chapter.
Okay.
Anyone with a question again?
Ma'am, that 150 lin Q, is it the one that we got on top?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Remember, we had 150 lin Q plus C. Then we added, we substituted the value of C, which was that other long part, which is this one.
Sorry, ma'am. May you scroll upwards, please? Thank you.
Down?
Just a little bit down. I want to see the function further down.
150 over Q?
Yeah.
Do you have a question based on this question, on this function?
No, ma'am, my laptop turned off while you were busy. So I just I just wanted to see the equation.
And let's continue. So again, suppose you are given the marginal revenue as marginal revenue equals 150 minus 3Q, right? And then you are asked to find the total revenue function, given that the total revenue for selling 10 units is 1,000. Okay, there we were given the marginal cost and we also find the total revenue. We integrated the marginal cost and then we substituted those two values. Now we are given the marginal revenue. We are asked to find the total revenue function, right? Remember, I said the total revenue is, you can find the total revenue by integrating the marginal revenue, right? Okay. And you are asked to find the total revenue. Okay, you are asked to find the total revenue function, given that the total revenue for selling 10 units is equal to 1,000, right? So this simply means the total revenue is 1,000 whenever Q is 10. Okay, but let's find let's integrate the marginal revenue first. Okay. I'm just going to substitute this 150 minus 3Q, right? If we integrate 150, we'll have 150Q. And if you integrate minus 3Q, you'll get minus 3 over 2Q squared. Again, we add the constant of integration, right? And then I said we were given an extra additional information that if the total revenue, okay, the total revenue is 1,000 whenever Q, the quantity, is the units at 10. Okay, the total revenue for selling 10 units is 1,000, right? Okay, you just have to substitute 1,000 where there is a total revenue. Okay, so that means we'll have 1,000 equals 150 times, we substitute 10, minus 3 over 2, we substitute 10 again, squared, plus C, right? Okay, then from here, we can solve for C, right? Okay, this is 1,000 equals 1500 minus 150 plus C, right? If you transpose this 150 and this 1,500 to the other side and minus 150, you will have C equals minus 350. And the next step is to put back the value of C. So this means the total revenue function would be equals 150Q minus 3 over 2Q squared. Then you add this value of C, which is minus 350. And this would be the total revenue function given the marginal revenue. And you were told that the total revenue of selling 10 units is 1,000. Then this is what you should obtain if you were given such information. Do we have questions?
Sorry, ma'am. On the second step, what did you do there to get that 150 Q? Where does the Q come from?
150 Q? Here. Okay, I integrated 150. I got 150 Q. I integrated minus 3 Q. I got minus 3 over 2 Q squared. Then plus the constant of integration. Remember the integral of the constant from last class, which was on Monday, we said if we integrate a constant, maybe with respect to x, then the integral you should obtain is a constant times that variable we are integrating with respect to. Do we have questions before we move on to our last part?
Yes, ma'am. Is this no visual class?
What do you mean?
I don't see any screen.
I don't know. Maybe
restart your PC, bro.
You have a network issue.
Oh.
Or exit and come back again.
Okay.
Any more questions?
So the brother for the whole the hour I didn't see anything. Sure.
Pardon?
Okay. I get a positive 350 instead of a negative 350.
It's positive. Yeah, it is positive, you're right.
Okay, because, it's fine, then it means
no, it's negative because this 150 when it's 1500 when it's go to that side, it would be negative. So we'll have a positive 1000 minus 1500, right? It will give us minus 500. And then if we transpose that minus 150 to that side of the equal sign, we'll get a positive 150.
Yeah, it's negative. Because we're going to be left with minus 500 plus 300 plus 150. That is going to be negative 350 minus.
Yes. Okay. Any more questions? All right. I think we should move on to our last part, which is applying the definite integral to determine the consumer surplus, producer surplus, and the total surplus. So we want to determine this consumer surplus and producer and the total using the definite integral. Okay. If you check your study guide, you have these formulas. Excuse me. You have consumer surplus equals the integral from zero to naught of the demand function.
Which page on our study guide, ma'am?
I'm not sure. Please check on the application of integral consideration. Okay.
It's page 1.
The integral with respect to Q then minus this, the initial conditions. And also we have this. Please confirm with me if they are correct.
Yes, the consumer surplus is correct.
Which page is it?
109.
But what's DQ, ma'am, after the demand function and the formula, consumer surplus?
Because it means you'll integrate the demand function with respect to Q.
Oh.
And then we have the total. Right? Okay. Because we have the formulas now, and I've shown you how to integrate. Just take this as an example exercise, I mean. I will give you 10 minutes, you guys, to do this exercise. Okay, we have the demand function. Then after that 10 minutes, we'll do it together as 200. Minus 0.4 Q, and the supply function is given as 2 e to the power 0.6 Q, right? Okay, we have the demand function and the supply function. Here, P represent price, and Q is for quantity. Okay, please find these two. And yeah, these questions are there. If you get maybe, okay, because usually they ask you to find the consumer supplies. They give you the same function. They ask you to find the producer supplies. They give you the same function. And then the third question will be the total supplies. So if you don't know how to integrate these kind of functions, then let me see. Okay, this time the questions are 25 each. That means you lose 16 marks. 16? Because it's 4, 4, 4. No, it's 12. Yeah. Please try and attempt this using those formulas. Do you want me to show you the formulas, or do you have your study guides open? Okay. Here you have to find the consumer surplus and the producer surplus at equilibrium market. Remember, at equilibrium, we'll have the demand equals the supply. So you'll have to equate these two, the demand function and the supply function, to get this. Right? And then, after having these, you can just substitute, you can just go back to this formula. You have this function, you have this, and you have this. That means we have these two. I guess it's all about punching this in your calculator. But the hint is to equate these two. 200E minus 0.4Q and 2E to the power 0.6Q. And then you solve for Q and P. From here, you see from here, you'll find the value of Q. Once you have the value of Q, you can substitute that value whether here or here. You should get the same answer. Doesn't matter. You substitute to which function, the demand function or the supply function. Okay, guys, your 10 minutes start now. We'll do these two questions. Quarter past? Yeah, we'll start to get it. Quarter past. Do we have questions before we start?
Sorry, ma'am. I had a network issue. I just logged in right now, so I don't know which topic are you on. Are you on the producer and surplus function? Or consumer and producer surplus function?
You are doing this exercise.
Okay.
Are you guys winning? Yes, no?
Yes, ma'am. Let's find Q together. Divided this with everything. Okay, let me just divide with everything. It doesn't matter which side you choose to divide with, the answer will be the same. So let me just divide with this. Oh, maybe let's leave 1,000 and divide with this parts only. -0.4 Q. This and this will cancel out. And here we have, we'll be left with 100, right? At this side, we'll have 0.6 Q minus, or it's plus 0.4 for Q, and we have 1,000 equals E Q, right? Okay. Here, to get from here to get to the steps, to the step, I use the laws of exponent. If you are dividing two numbers, okay, if you are dividing two functions and their bases are the same, you can subtract the exponent, can subtract the exponent of the denominator from the exponent of the numerator. That's why I have 0.6 minus of -0.4. Minus and minus will give us positive. That's why I have +0.4. That's the rule I use there, right? And then from here, we can introduce ln on both sides. If you introduce ln, this is the same thing as Q ln E, and this is equal to 1. So this means we have Q equals ln of 100. Did you get the same thing?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then the next step is to find
is to find P. Remember, I said you can substitute to any of the two functions. It doesn't matter, you'll get the same answer. Okay. I'll substitute this in the this value. Is it equals 2e 0.6 ln of hundreds. Guys, please check for me what do you get on your calculator.
Seven.
Okay, here the trick is when before you get to the final answer, do not round off your answer, right? Just write the all those numbers as they are. You can round off at the end on the final answer. Okay, but let's assume this was the just these five numbers, three decimals. Okay, let's suppose this is what we get. We did not round off. Okay, then the consumer surplus would equals to, we have zero, then we have ln of hundreds, right? The demand function, yes.
Ma'am, I beg you to revisit to start again. I'm lost. I can't follow you.
Where did I lose you?
But 0.6 less 0.4, we got, it says you got Q.
Because it's 0.6 plus 0.1, 0.4, that will give you 1, right? So we have 1 times Q. There's no need for us to write 1.
Oh, okay. Then I get
it. Is it fine?
Yeah, let's go down. Yeah, the way we use the ln, I'm totally lost. I can't understand those things.
If you have the something ln, like this, you want to solve for this variable, you need to introduce ln on both sides. That's why I have ln of this and ln. I introduced ln on both sides, because the aim was to get rid of this exponent e, right?
Okay.
That's the reason, yes, why I introduced ln on both sides. Then I said this is equal to this, right? And this part, ln e, is the same thing as 1, is equal to 1. So this means we have q is equal to ln hundreds. Is this one fine?
Yes, yeah, it's fine.
Then I took this q, I substituted here on the surplus on the supply function, right? And this is what I obtained. I said after finding Q, you can either substitute it on the demand function or on the supply function. You always get the same Q, right? The same P.
Oh, okay. Then I think it. I don't know how to punch those numbers on the calculator. Maybe if you can.
You don't know how to punch this in your calculator. Do you have a calculator?
Yes, I have a calculator.
Which calculator are you using?
The financial calculator.
Does it have E and Lim?
Yes, it has E to the power X.
Yes, that's E, right? I don't have a calculator. That's E.
Mm-hmm.
So it should be E to the power 0.6 times. You can put E and then you put to the power, you put a bracket, you put 0.6 times lin 100. You close your bracket. Are you winning?
I'm still finding. It's giving me errors. But maybe if you can write down the what you are saying, they write it down. Then maybe I will do it during my own spare time.
This is what I'm writing, right? This is what you need to punch in your calculator to get this.
I mean, like the steps of maybe you write E to the power X bracket, then I will punch them in.
This is what you need to punch in your calculator, this as it is.
Oh, okay, no, I will practice it. Maybe I will get it right. If I don't get it right, I will send my calculation.
Because these questions are there in the exam.
Yeah, I'm not getting it right. Maybe it's the settings of my calculator is giving me 100.
Is it radians or degrees?
It got two. It's like it's orange and blue.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know which one do you have and what is showing in your screen.
Yeah, I engage, ma'am. I think if you can go to YouTube as well, because it's gonna be a struggle. Trust me.
I also don't know how to use a calculator. I did the math without a calculator. We're not allowed to use a calculator.
What? So you crammed all this ease on your head. I understand another one.
They showed us tricks on how to calculate, how to divide, how to multiply. I can do them with hands. Yeah.
Hey, you're from the Einstein age, eh? But no, okay.
Okay, then we have in this, we're calculating a surplus. Yes?
Just to clarify, lin E to the power of Q is the same as Q lin E.
What? This part?
Yes.
Yes, it's the same as you have to take out down the exponent. So, if you had lin Q, maybe x squared, this is the same thing as x squared lin E, and you know this is one.
Yes, okay, thank you.
Your battery's gonna die, man, by the way.
It's my battery's on. What? OK. Okay, it's charging now. Thank you. So we have 200 demand function E minus 0.4 Q, right? Then differential integrating with respect to Q minus P naught times Q naught, right? P naught and Q naught are these two values. It's this one and this lin 100, right? Okay, I just want to do the integral part, because here you know you multiply these two numbers that you got there. Okay, can write this as 200. We can take out the constant and write this as 0 lin of 100 E minus 0.4 EQ minus P naught Q naught, right? If you integrate this, you should get 200 times minus 1 over, we are dividing now, 0.4 E minus 0.4 Q. And then you have limits 0 and lin 100, right? And then we still have this minus P naught and Q naught, those two numbers you obtained there on top, right? Then the next step is to substitute these two, our limits. And if you substitute our limits, you should have 200 over into 1 over 0.4, right? E minus 0.4 lin of 100. We are substituting the lower the upper limit first, right? Then we have we'll have minus of minus 1 over 0.4 E minus 0.4 times 0, right? Then please don't forget this part. Right? And this will give you 200 into minus 1 over 0.4 E minus 0.4 lin 100. Then here we have 0 times 0.4, that is 0. E to the power 0 is 1. So that means we have 1 times minus 1 over 0.4. That means we have minus times minus, that will give us plus 1 over 0.4, right? And then please don't forget that part, EQ, right? And then if you simplify this, you should have something like this. 200, I'm taking out a common factor, over 0.4 into minus E minus 0.4 lin of 100 plus 1 minus P remember, and here we have numbers. So it's this minus this. That would be your consumer surplus. And then again, you use the producer surplus equation to find that you have equals, okay, we do have these two, right? Minus 0, ln of 100 of 2a 0.6q with respect to q. We are integrating with respect to q. First, I will take out the constant, which is 2, outside the integral sign. And that means I will have 2 integral from 0 to ln 100 of e 0.6q, and I'm integrating with respect to q, right? And then if we integrate this, this is what we'll obtain. One over 0.6 e 0.6 q. Then you have your limit 0 and ln 100. Again, you substitute your limit here. If you substitute them, you'll have pq minus 2 times 1 over 0.6 e to the power 0.6 ln 100 minus 1 over 0.6 e 0.6 times 0, right? And if you simplify this, you will have, should obtain pq minus 2 into 1 over 0.6 e 0.6 ln 100, right? Minus 1 over 0.6. You can take out 0.6 from here, or you can just punch everything in your calculator from here, and that will be your final answer. If you were asked to find the total surplus, you were going to add these two. Yes? That's... And do you
have the exact number?
Do you have the exact number? Along, and it's very easy to make this.
We're getting lost.
But the trick is to make sure that you do not round off your answer until you get to the final answer.
Okay.
Only this class in the morning, not this time.
Ma'am, can I ask you something? Because when I was doing this topic, we're using the textbook, right? And I understood the textbook. And I was doing the questions that you gave us based on my knowledge of the textbook. And what you are doing and what's there, it's totally different. So now I am very lost. In the test or exam, you won't need like the in the test or the exam, you won't need like the final answer. We have to do it like your way.
What do you mean you won't need a final answer?
I don't know, because when we were like when I was doing textbook way, it's different from what you are doing right now. That's what I'm asking.
They give you the final answer.
Yes.
Oh, the thing is, I don't have a calculator. I can't punch this and check the final answer. But
you just have to punch everything
in your calculator and you get the final answer.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Here I was just doing the summary of the chapter. I didn't want to teach everything step by step. Let me give you what you need.
Thank you.
Okay. Do we have questions?
How many marks is this question? So that I can skip it.
Okay. In the exam.
She said
25. 25.
You?
Yes,
no?
You'll be given
25
questions, right?
Oh, question.
Okay, how many questions do you have?
So that's, this means each question will contribute 4 marks. That means 4%. If you skip this session, that means you lose 12 marks, 12%.
Yeah.
There are 12 questions in the section of the exam.
There are 25 questions, and 3 questions, 1 consumer surplus, producer surplus, total surplus.
Oh, it's week 12.
Okay, my follow-up question, based on this section, if we do it the textbook way, are we still going to be right, as long as the answer is right?
It's the same thing. This